Everybody, it's old pal Ola Millet here. Hope you're going well. It's Tuesday night. We're halfway through April, and Easter is just gone if you're a Western Christian. But if you're Eastern Orthodox, hope you have a good Easter like this coming weekend and all. And also, if you're Jewish, I hope you have had a good Passover, because Passover and Holy Thursday tend to always be on like the same date. I mean, one time at an Anglican church, we did like a similar Passover meal at an Anglican mass. No, not mass, like the church service. And it was on Holy Thursday. So, not how Christianity and Judaism dates kind of tend to collide. Kind of like with, you know, how the Jews have their Hanukkah around the same time as Christmas. So, yeah. Tonight's time for another story tale. And it's about the third time I moved to Birmingham. Now, in case you haven't read any of my previous blog posts on my website, Overland Metalhead, I moved to Birmingham twice in July 2015 and April 2016. Now, for first move, basically, I got a place to rent, but I wasn't really that successful in getting jobs. I got a trial, I got sworn at by a chef, I was very unhappy, so I left. And then the second attempt was, basically, I got a place to rent. Fucking hated the housemates in the time of the whole EU referendum because they were pigs who can clean up and clean everybody, bloody all this. So I said some really nasty things to them, and so I left. And then I lost motivation to live in the United Kingdom and work. So then I ended up back in Birmingham on the last day of December 2016. So I just moved into a house again. And I told myself this has to work, because if you go back the third time, you may never come back to the United Kingdom. You'll be stuck in Australia, you'll be stuck in Israel, contract jobs, you'll hate all the agency stuff you've worked with in Australia, so you better, like, stick the landing. So, I applied for benefits, JSA, and the people at the Job Centre office, they send me to a restaurant called, like, the Halfpenny Inn in Albury. Look it up on the map. The guy there, Richard, he was a nice guy, but I just noticed that he was, in my opinion, I thought he was xenophobic. He asked me, well, why you came here and stuff, and I thought, dude, I'm here to be a waiter and stuff. Because I was born Australian, it doesn't give you the right to ask me that question when I'm showing you my proof of British citizenship. And so he was, in my opinion, just a retarded knob who tried to offer me a kitchen porter job. And people offer me a kitchen porter job and I show them on my resume that I've worked a waiter, I feel like saying, you take that job and you shove it up your ass and you go out and you go find a refugee from the Horn of Africa and you give it to that person, because I believe an Eritrean refugee is a much more deserving of getting a dishwashing job in the UK than I am, because I've done it for like 5 years and stuff. So I had like a few job interviews and stuff, and even a trial, and just all like rejections, and all basically all a few like FUs and stuff. So then, my first job I ever worked in the United Kingdom was working at Wolverhampton Wools. I was assigned to work there because of Blue Arrow, another agency who I never really got along with and stuff. Now, agencies are just basically people who send you to work at shit locations, doing shit hours for shit pay. And basically, you're just filling in a void. There's like, oh, there's a game where Wolverhampton Wolves at Aston Villa. Oh, we need a lot of people, and because we don't have Aston Villa football, doesn't have that many people on payroll. So, week after working Wolverhampton Wolves, I gained employment with Barry Recruitment. And so Barry Recruitment gave me like jobs at Aston Villa, which was a good place to work at, serving people, selling beer, selling hot food and all. But that's not only just a game day, that's not like an ongoing thing. Then they started making me go from Birmingham to Stafford, which is in western mileage, we use kilometres, it was like a 100 kilometre round trip from my house in Birmingham to Stafford, clean the kitchen for 4 hours and go back. On a good day, if I didn't want to pay much money in transport, I could buy a day saver ticket that could get me from my house to Wolverhampton, then to Stafford, and then from Stafford to Wolverhampton back to Birmingham. Well, but other days it was more like a jackass saying, alright, I'm going to get a bus to Birmingham New Street, then I'm going to take a train to Stafford, and then I'm going to get a train back to Stafford. And then I realised, okay, well, maybe if I just get a bus from my house to Wolverhampton and then a train from Wolverhampton to Stafford. So that went on for most of February. Then in March, I gained a full-time job with the same company and stuff. They wanted me to work at this place, at this, it was like a car warehouse where basically I just feed the people, like the workers and all. It was a full-time job. The full-time work lasted for 2.5 weeks, and then they were like, sorry, they don't need you anymore. You have to, like, go, but here's this other company. So they made me work at Alstom Grid in Stafford. So yet again, the long trip to Stafford. And the people at that Alstom Grid warehouse, basically, I could describe them as being dumb, bald, obese, chain-smoking, fish-and-chipping, xenophobic, racist, white British bastards. And they just, I go into work, and the security guys, is there a bomb in your bag and stuff? And so I reported him, and then, I reported him, and I just went on with my work, and it was just horrible. It was just a 4-hour job going from Birmingham to Stafford to clean a warehouse. I cleaned kitchens before, but I'm not qualified to go into a warehouse and clean the shit out of it, and clean toilets, and clean the floors, and just clean the offices. Then all a tragic event happened one night when I was seeing my favorite band Dream Theater in Birmingham. I got punched out by an Eastern European person because he was asking me for cigarettes. I said, sorry, I don't smoke. And he accused me of swearing at him. So he punched me in the nose, and then his white British friend just whacks me in the head with a ball and socket. So I'm bleeding from my nose, my scalp, and nobody in the streets of Birmingham is fucking helping me. I'm bleeding and stuff. But then this bouncer, who was a lovely Muslim man outside of a strip club, he noticed how hurt I was, and he gave me some blue roll paper to stop the bleeding. And then he called over the police. The police came, they arrested one of the bastards and all. And then I had to go to like hospital with the police in an ambulance, make a report of what had happened and stuff. The guy who whacked me in the head was arrested and got sent to jail for 2.5 years and stuff. The guy punched me in the nose, then got caught and all. And then also the police in Birmingham were pigs. And yeah, and I didn't really get along with them and stuff. And so then I was having down spiral at my job at Berry Recruitment. They sent me to Doncaster the weekend before, and they wanted me to work at an Indian wedding for 13 hours from 9 o'clock to 11 o'clock at night, and they expect me to be at this other job, West Midlands, the next morning at 9. And as a guy who was raised in Australia with a lot of high standards, this goes against what I've been raised. Because I believe that there must be 12 hours between a shift. I believe we're not allowed to work so many days in a row. Because if that's happening, I have to put my hand up and say, hey, this is wrong. I can't work 6 days in a row. Or I can't work with a 13-hour shift and you expect me to work another 10 hours at another job in another part of West Midlands. So abruptly, a few weeks after, days after I got like punched out and all, I was at Coventry at a boxing arena, just a boxing event. This guy was just being hopeless in his job, so I threw the tray on the ground and I just walked out and I quit by text. So I told people, Barry, I quit. And so days later, I moved out of Birmingham. I traveled all the way down to Falmouth in Cornwall. And I started a job at the Rising Sun Hotel in St. Mawes, which is across the bay from Falmouth. And the job was going to be, well, a full-time kitchen porter. I get to like live across the river from the hotel and stuff, and I get like 2 days off work a week. But then as I'm working there, I'm working with this narcissist, Dr. Peter, who's a closed-minded person, and he's always smoking and swearing and saying, oh, you gotta cut a bucket of chips every 5 minutes. So by the half of the day, I was like, I'm gonna quit. I quit three jobs within like under 2 weeks. So I just wrote an email to the manager saying, I don't want a job, but I work 5 hours, please give my wages to charity. And so I pissed off. I left Falmouth and I travelled to the very bottom of the United Kingdom, the Land's End. And then it took me 6 days to travel up to John O'Groats, the top of Scotland. I wanted to live with one of my cousins in Newcastle, but my dad's family, they have never ever been supportive of me living in this country. And this cousin, he's a good guy and stuff, but he's just like really happily married, like with a woman in his life and all that. He doesn't need extra money. And yeah. And but I did want to like live in Newcastle because it was, I knew it was a cheap rent. But even if you come to a country with a lot of money, a lot of agencies in real estate, they won't give you a house to rent, a room to rent, unless you have a decent amount of money. So I go back to Birmingham. I stayed in a hostel, had Birmingham backpacks for a few days. My friend Sue, who I worked with in Stafford, she said, "Oh, come and stay at my house. I'm not far from Stafford," and all. So I stayed a whole week at her and all. And then when I was like leaving Sue's house to go back to Birmingham, I looked at flights. And I was thinking, well, with the amount of money I got left, I could go to Norway and then I could go back to Australia, or I could go to Japan and visit this friend, Momo Geisha in Sapporo, but nothing really materialized. So then I just went back to like looking for like jobs. I had a job interview at this restaurant in Paavon Kitchen, and they asked me the same stupid xenophobic questions, like, "Oh, why are you kind of staff?" And they say people from Birmingham travel to London for work, and I just kind of think in this day and age, nobody would have the money to travel from Birmingham to London every day for work unless you're super rich, or unless you had a pair of work wheels, or unless you were a contractor and stuff. I mean, and then after many days of being in those hostels, there was no room for me at this hostel on a Saturday night. Like, it was like last Saturday in May. It was like the same week of the attacks in Manchester. And then so I just took a bus to London and I slept up inside of Victoria Coach Station overnight. And then I went back to Birmingham the next day. I checked back into the hostel and I sit into a closed, like, one of those capsule hotels you see in Japan. With my curtains shut, I'm just like sitting up and I'm like, I just can't no longer live in Birmingham anymore. People are just being xenophobic to me because I wasn't born in this country. People are not giving me a chance. The pay rate is crap and stuff. But I've always had a love of Birmingham and a hatred of London. But there was only one thing like left to do. So like, I left Birmingham on the 2nd of June, 2017, and traveled all the way down to London. I was gonna see Fate's Warning that night with Arthur, but because I had a really bad doner kebab, I was just having a lot of really bad bowel issues. So I decided I would continue like living in like I live in London. And so, which is what I've been doing since June 2017, if you just disregard my 2 months away, 2018. Now, I do have a deep connection with Birmingham because I lived across the road from an Anglican church. Quinton Parish Church was across the road from my house. I would go there every Sunday when I lived in Birmingham. And so, since I moved to London, I always make an effort, and like once or twice a year, go up to Birmingham, see my old church friends, tell them how everything good is in London and stuff, and just shock them at how I haven't been able to go back to Australia in a lot of time. So, in the times like I left, I moved to London, I would have to come back to Birmingham every now and then because I was registered with a GP there. So every month I'd be like, "Hey, it's Martin Anthony. I need my medications. So I'll pick it up." And so I get on a bus, go out to Birmingham, collect my medication, and then go all the way back down to like London and then go back to work the next day. I had to, in the 2017 election, I had to go up to Birmingham to vote because that's where I was registered, and so that's what I did. This one day when I got a paycheck, my final paycheck off the government, off of my JSA, Job Seeker Allowance, I got £40. So I went out to Warsaw, and I got with this porn star called Francesca. I'm not gonna give any more details. It was a blissful 15 minutes with a porn star slash prostitute or escort, and it's kind of funny how I paid those xenophobic bastards in Birmingham and Stafford. I used their tax money to get with a porn star, so I was kind of like, "Well, fuck you, you bloody xenophobic. You don't. You need to read the British Migration Act of 1983 that says people born abroad to British parents have the right to come back to the United Kingdom, and if you don't like it, you're xenophobic." So, I remain focused on London, but I'd have to take a trip to Birmingham once a month for medications. Then, Birmingham, I just thought, started crumbling down with the doctors basically like, "You don't live here, you don't live in Birmingham anymore, please stop coming up and asking for medications, go register with a doctor in London." So that was a huge hurdle I had to get over after I moved to London, because being not having a fixed address, I moved hostels every fortnight. So then I found this doctor in, I call him Northern Line, like Dr. ZZ, and she's just horrible. Like I told her all my medical conditions and stuff, and I just wanted this injection, this testosterone injection I have every 3 months. And she's like, no, we haven't got new information, we can't give you this thing. And I feel like saying, lady, I have an NHS number. All you had to do was ask my last GP in Birmingham to send my file to London, which would be sent it immediately, just by the power of the internet. Then in 2018, I got myself a proper doctor at Willesden Green, not far from where I was like living. And I still in my hostels. They allowed me to register, see my doctor every now and then. That's good. As for Birmingham, since I left Birmingham, I've only really, like, in 2008, I only spent like 4 days in Birmingham. Like, I had 3 days in Birmingham kicking around before I moved back to London after my time in Sweden. And then there's this one day when, like, I've had to fly from Birmingham to Mexico for my Christmas holiday. Then last year, I flew back to Birmingham New Year's Day, and then I went to Birmingham, LeMay to see my church friends on a Sunday, because if I get work off on a Sunday, I will likely go out to Birmingham, despite the fact it's really a tight schedule getting a train up there and trying to make it in time for mass and see a lot of people I love up there. But then this year, I was in Birmingham in February just for just one night stay, then I went back the next day after seeing my church friends, and I just didn't expect to like move back up here. Now, you may think, all right, well, Martin, you're back in Birmingham. Do you really want to get a job here? I'm like, no, I don't want to resume like work here because I have a job in London, and I can go back to it when they need me. I'm only staying here because, I mean, rent is a lot more cheaper in Birmingham than it is in London. But I tell you one thing, hostels are a lot more cheaper in London than they are in Birmingham. So if you're one of those people who are like drifters in life and you got a fixed address, or you're just like traveling around the UK trying to like do your own thing, I would consider moving to London, getting a hostel for a certain period of time, and then once getting a job, getting a proper place to like rent and all. Because after all, you're gonna find more work in London than any other city in the whole United Kingdom. So anyway, that kind of explains my Mark 3 of living in Birmingham. This is Over the Millhead, over and